I think we're going to get started here. We're running a little late because Naomi is doing a fabulous interview. Welcome to our the Public Intellectual Part 3, which begins today, headed by the inestimable Dr. Naomi Wolf, who is, as I've introduced before, the Mary Wollstonecraft of today's public sphere, and the author of 8 best-selling times, best-selling books in the New York Times, which is really very exciting and beyond the ken of most of the people who teach her. I'll tell you that right now. She's also very impressively the CEO of the Daily Clout, which is doing lots of energetic work and getting a sort of left liberal view out there and cogitating amongst the circulatory networks that we make today. And I think that that's really one of the most fantastic things she's done in a long time. Her books are very important, but the outreach I think is just particularly important in a moment when it's time for us to stand up and be counted and say what we think. And I think she is very much helping us do that. Today I think she's going to talk about the op-ed, which is right up the street of this. And so with no further ado, I'm going to turn you over to Naomi Wolf.
Thank you.
We love having you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Wilson. And, one of the many things I love about Stony Brook, and I say this every time, is she, uses Mary Wollstonecraft and me in the same sentence. So she just did it again, which, just put such a smile on my face. It's a pleasure to be here. I know we're starting a little late, so thank you. And so I'm going to just plunge right in to our topic today, which is op-ed writing. And we also are going to be reaching, hopefully tens or hundreds of thousands of people out there in the world, globally, because Medium is the message. This series is about being a public intellectual and having a global public voice. And the miracle of the technologies that we have today, actually, I don't need this, right, because I might. Thank you. The miracle of the technologies that we have today is that we can stand here in this lovely poetry center at Stony Brook University. And by the way, a shout out to the Humanities Center, which supports and pioneers the public intellectuals outreach that's part of what we're doing here today, as well as many other exciting events that you should look at online. The Alan Alda Center, also public outreach for the sciences, and Stony Brook University as a whole. But because of this camera and this thing strapped to me, which is amplifying my voice, we're not just learning something together here today, we're learning it in concert with people around the world and over time, right? So what we're going to be talking about today builds on the first two lectures in this series or presentations. So those of you who were at all, now three of them, you'll recognize the building, and those of you who weren't, I really recommend when these links are posted that you take them in sequence, because the first one leads to the second one leads to the third one, and the last one will crown everything we've learned. And what you'll see is that, and here I'm doing what I tell you to do, I'm telling you what I said, I'm telling you what I'm telling you, and then I'm telling you what I'm going to say, so you'll have a sense of structure. The first and second seminars talked about how to structure a pitch, right? How to just say in a few sentences what your thought, mission, idea is about. As Professor Nancy Heemstra initially thought about how she would communicate what she's working on, I'm using her as an example, on immigrant raids and detention. Then we looked at public presentation, right? How you communicate that verbally. And now we're looking at stretching. Remember I said everything I taught you can be expanded or contracted, right? But it's the same basic DNA of messaging. Now we're talking about an op-ed format, and we foregrounded this a little bit in the first seminar, where you're saying in 8 to 1200 words a tiny, beautiful argument, right? And I just want to give a shout out to why the op-ed form is so important, so impactful, so critical. You can't be a public intellectual if you don't know how to write an op-ed, but you could do absolutely anything in the world if you know how to write an op-ed. In terms of, remember the first session, those of you who were there, what are some of the things you can do very quickly if you get an op-ed about your issue in the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal or the LA Times? Some things you get quickly. Do you get more help in the form of, say, access to research money, people reaching out to you and saying, I believe this is a problem, constituents, more support of all kinds, more invitations to speak more about the issue, just reprising the many, many things that a good op-ed opens the door to, right? The other thing, and this is a reprise, that a good op-ed in a major news outlet opens the door to is additional appearances. Because if you write a good op-ed in the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal or some other national venues, that goes right into the Rolodex or whatever the digital equivalent is of TV producers and radio producers. And if your subject is hot, like Professor Heemstra's subject, immigration and detention right now is super, super white hot because of national news events, then it means that producers will call you, right? There are things you can do to push that forward in case the producers haven't called you in the volume that you want after your last fantastic op-ed. But you know, there's also outreach you can do then with that link. You can then email producers and with the link embedded and say, I wrote this op-ed, I really want to talk about this issue. You can lecture on the issue. You can you know, mobilize support of all kinds. If you are running a political campaign, you really want to make change, you can use the op-ed to knock on the door of donors, to knock on the door of policymakers. It's an incredibly powerful thing, and often it leads to a nonfiction book contract. If you write a fabulous op-ed bringing up something that no one's ever thought of before, or if you've had a personal experience, like when I was last here, when I taught here at Stony Brook 2015 to 2016, I got a piece of writing from a young man who grew up in a tiny, beleaguered African village, and he learned how to read from scraps of an English textbook that was left in the mud outside his house, right? And he was sick for 2 years and bedridden, and that's how he learned to read. And now he's just swimming in language, and I'm like, oh my God, you've got to write that book, right? So the way you get started isn't by sending a proposal to a book agent, although we're going to get into that in the last session. The way you get started is by writing a fantastic op-ed telling the world, this is how I learned to read, and this is what I think about what I've learned. All right, so it's so, so, so powerful. So in a world of endless blogging, what's different about an op-ed? And why do I love that format so much? What's different is that it's the tight scope and the classical genre forces you to think more clearly. It forces you to condense your thoughts and to make them make sense, crystalline sense. And a blog is just you ranting, okay? There's a big difference, so don't be fooled. An 800-word or a 1,200-word blog is not an op-ed, right? It isn't. So just because you know how to blog or rant doesn't mean you know how to write an op-ed. Put more constructively, if you know how to write an op-ed, your thoughts that you might have wasted in a blog or rant can be shared, have impact, change people's minds. All right. So what I'm going to do is, you know, go over quickly some of the key points, and I reviewed them in my first presentation, and it's worth repeating, right? Because this is, as I said, the DNA, right? Your DNA. This is absolutely the structure that you must master in order to write a good op-ed. It doesn't change, and if you understand the structure, you can do anything with your writing. And after I reprise that, I really want to get into showing you very quickly a terrible op-ed and a very good op-ed, and I didn't get your permission, but it's out there in public, so I just reprinted Professor Heemstra's very good op-ed about the ICE raids, because it's a perfect example of what I'm talking about, and I also thought it would be inspiring to you, because it's one of yours, and she learned really quickly, just like all of you can learn this really quickly. It's not rocket science, though it's impactful. And then after I've kind of shared the basics of this good writing with you, I want to go around and do some hand coaching with your pitches so we can hear more about what each of you is doing that you might want to write an op-ed about. And then in the last half hour or so, I'll have you actually do some writing and write a draft op-ed, okay? And don't be scared or alarmed that I'm pushing you, right, to jump in with both feet, because the number one, there are a lot of number one problems that budding writers have in this space, if they're hard to kind of prioritize, but one of the top number one problems of the many number ones is people overthink it, and they think that they have to be, you know, Wolf Blitzer or Noam Chomsky, and that's the worst thing you can do with your op-ed writing. I'm not saying underthink it. I can show you on my phone an example I got this morning of someone underthinking it. You don't want to do that. But you do want to get in the habit of just writing, and I'm such a nag about this. My friends here at Stony Brook will tell you, I'm like, you know, Dr. Wilson, you've got to write that. You've got to write that. And it's what you should be doing is forcing yourself to practice, just like I encourage you to force yourself to practice grabbing every chance to engage in public speaking about what you care about, to give an interview, you know, plunge into that public space, even if you're scared of it. But what you really need to start doing, like literally day by day, automatically, the way, you know, you have an automatic kind of, did I get enough steps on my Fitbit, you know, whatever, did I feed the cat, right? That automatic level of attention and thought, I want you to start noticing what your inner monologue is, what's annoying you, or what's nagging at you. I'm sorry to say that usually great op-eds come out of things that are wrong rather than things that are making you happy, because it's not much of a news hook to say, you know, I'm really enjoying my garden. You know, you can get to I'm really enjoying my garden by telling me what was wrong with access to gardens in Long Island before, or what's endangered about what you love about your garden as GMO seeds come into your beautiful garden. But scan your brain day by day for the things, you know, when people watched television, I used to say the things that made you want to throw something at the TV, right? That's your great op-ed, right? That's what you should be writing about. And I've said this before in this series, but I'm saying it again. Really, I want you to believe it. It is, if you think, well, I'm only 21, or I'm not an old white guy from, you know, with 10 Yale degrees, that is exactly who should be writing op-eds, right? If you, I've said this before, I'm saying it again, if you are from a non-dominant subculture, awesome, right? Fabulous. It means that you are a voice that editors want to get into the mix because it's disproportionately male. Only 30% of op-ed bylines are by women. Op-ed editors are always saying, I can't get women, because when I call a woman, she says, I'm not an expert, and refers me to a man. Right? Horrible. So if you're a woman, write op-eds. If you're a person of color, write op-eds. If you're an immigrant, write op-eds. If you're, you know, a new kind of gender identity, you know, write an op-ed about it. You know, like, you should hear me when I get a voice that I haven't heard before. I have an intern at Daily Clout who has been writing, you know, very straightforward policy stuff about, you know, Trump's healthcare bill, and it's fine. And then when he said, you know, nobody's really written an op-ed about how great it is to be celibate and to speak up for people who choose celibacy, I'm like, you gotta write that op-ed. You know, be the celibate guy, right? Like, get it out there. You know, tell us what's so great about celibacy and why celibate people are, you know, silenced, and what we don't know about people who are choosing celibacy, right? Because I know about people who are choosing sex, right? It's everywhere. I don't know enough about. You know, and he was, you know, 21, and it's like, oh my God, this is a gold mine, fantastic. So don't wait to be Wolf Blitzer or Noam Chomsky. You'll never be, you know, you just won't be that person. And as I think Oscar Wilde said, be yourself, everyone else is already taken. So it couldn't be better. So, you know, also don't rule out, you think it, people often, when they're new at this, think it has to be like sounding like a State of the Union address. No, no, no. It has to be about national policy, foreign policy. No. Think about what you and your friends are talking about. right? And look at, like with an anthropological eye, what your subgroup is talking about. When I was a mom and I noticed that there was not a playground with shade anywhere, you know, and all of the moms were hot and there was no food or, you know, rarely anything to drink, they were hungry and thirsty, that's a great op-ed about how public space doesn't value women and mothers and children. You know, that's a great little op-ed. If your friends are getting tattoos, you know, with something on them, that's a great op-ed. Why is that? If, I mean, I often use this example, I'm not sure if I've used it here, the hipsters carrying puppies, have I used that example? But you know where I'm going, I live in the West Village. Suddenly I noticed there were all of these, you know, handsome young hipster men with beards and the shirts with the plaid, and they were all cradling puppies in their arms as they were walking about the streets. And I was like, and you know, the first time it's an individual, the second time it's a trend, the third time it's a cultural moment that you have to analyze. And you know, if you're a cultural critic, you start to say, what does it mean that these hipster young men are carrying puppies? It can mean a lot of interesting things. I can never prove conclusively why these guys suddenly started and have since stopped carrying puppies, but you know, there's a nice op-ed there about changing gender roles or the freedom to express their, you know, inner cuddliness or the ability to use the puppy as a babe magnet in a subversively neo-feminist but not really way. You know, like there's so much unpacking you can do about noticing three hipsters with three different puppies. Right? So just look around at your world and your friends and your situation. By the way, just saying, you know, I was hot at the playground and so were all the other moms, or I saw three hipsters with puppies, personal narrative is not an op-ed. Big abstract analysis, in my view, is very boring writing. The absolute best op-eds I see combine personal observation or stories, we'll get to that, about real people with bigger analysis and link them back and forth. All right. Does anyone have any questions about what I just said? Okay, what I'd like to do is zip through the kind of what and then start to do more interactive stuff. So let me go now to, you know, quickly reprise this DNA here, and what I'd like to do is I'm going to give this back to the wonderful Rachel Rodriguez at the end of the session, and she can upload it in a place where you can all retrieve it and reference it. But basically, your op-ed should be 8 to 1200 words. I gave an assignment to someone who's aspiring to write for Daily Clout, and we said clearly, it's 8 to 1200 words. And she was very promising. She sounded super smart. She really wants to join us. She turned in an op-ed that was 487 words and said, I just am not sure where to go with this. Don't be that person. And, you know, I had to write back saying, well, look at the bill and see what else there is to say about it, right? but the number of times people will submit, you know, the more usual error is to go over, yes, and to expect the editor to then, yeah, exactly. And, you know, as I often say, your editor is busy. She or he wants to get on the plane, go home to the children, feed the dog, whatever it is. She or he hates you and won't tell you if you make him or her cut those extra lines. That's not that person's job. You have to be a professional writer, meaning someone they want to work with again, by just following the rules about word count and style. You can be as innovative as you want in what you have to say, but if you don't engage in that social contract, then what you're basically saying is you don't respect this opportunity. And really, you're also saying you don't respect that editor. It's absolute. And you'll never hear from them again. Like, the most common thing is people will say, well, I sent an op-ed, I pitched it verbally, she was interested, I sent the op-ed, and I never heard from her again. And I always say, how long was it? And they always say 1,600 words. And I'm like, well, Now you know, right? They're not going to call you and say it's too long because they already told you that would be too long, right? And what you've got to know is that real journalists and real editors are, they're in news time, and news time is fast, right? And news time can't make any mistakes. So you never want to be that person that you have to go back and forth with more than for the real editing, which is actually making something better, right? Not fixing what shouldn't have been wrong in the first place. And you never want to make a mistake, right? I mean, it's not going to be, if you're a promising writer, I've certainly made mistakes, but it's your job as a writer to turn in a document that you have checked, like more than once, no typos, right? No grammatical errors. If you have any question about grammatical usage, Strunk and White, I've given you our style guide, the Daily Cloud style guide. People are not taught, I mean, I always sound like a dinosaur at this point, but at this point, I don't care. Hate me all you want. Someone has to tell you this. You are not taught grammar anymore, right? Your teachers just want to, like, someone I love dearly came home from a state university, and all she has been assigned in her, you know, 60s to the modern moment English literature class is pornographic cartoon books. And it's like, okay, there's a value in that genre, but that is not going to teach you grammar. You know, it's a cartoon book. What are those things called, even? A graphic novel. Thank you. See, I'm so old. A cartoon book, a graphic novel. So she's not getting grammar there. So go ahead to the library or order it from Amazon. It's worth it. Strunk and White. Read it. Reread it. Bore yourself to death. Read it in your sleep. Read it before you go to sleep so you dream about it. You have to know things like don't end a sentence with a preposition, right? You have to know that president and Congress is always capitalized. And you don't want to be that writer. Your young writers, it's okay with my young writers if they make a mistake once or twice. But when I have to keep saying, I never want you to use the passive voice, this is what the passive voice is, I want to kill myself. Right? And I also, again, you make your editor feel disrespected. And you're also not treating yourself like a serious person. So turn it around fast and be easy to edit is the op-ed. All right, so we talked about this in the last time, but I'm going to review it quickly here, news hook versus evergreen. Ideally, you want to have a news hook where whatever it is you want to say, like Nancy, Professor Heemster has been working on immigration for years, probably, right? Or some years, a while, how long?
Yeah, 10 years.
10 years, okay. But even if immigration issues were not in the news, the best thing she could do is to look for something in the news that she could tie it to. Even that, if that seems artificial, start in the middle of that story, you know, a group of six families were rounded up in Long Island, you know, on October 10th, 2016, well, ideally a more recent one, and use that, even if you have to make a transitional leap or stretch a little bit to what it is that you want to say. If you can't find any news hook at all, you're writing an evergreen piece, in which case it's less likely that it'll be used right then, but the editor may keep it for a while for when there's a slow news day, right? And that's like, you know, what's an evergreen piece? I mean, something that doesn't have an obvious news hook. Although pretty much everything can have an obvious news hook if you work hard enough. But an evergreen piece is kind of like, oh, those kids grow up so fast, right? An essay like that. It's always going to be true, but there's nothing pressing, right? Unless there's been some scientific discovery that makes them grow up slower, right? It's like, it's always the human condition. All right, we've done this before, I'm doing it again. Who, what, where in the top sentence then, transition, first graph, exposition, transition, topic sentence, second graph, exposition, transition, topic sentence, exposition, transition, conclusion. And I'm going over it fast because we've done it before, but it is critical that you structure it this way. Now let's look briefly at two different, I'm not going to look at one of them because it's not good, so I'm going to use it as a bad example, and I don't want to embarrass the writer by handing it out. But you can look at Professor Heemstra's piece, which is This Is Fear, ICE Raids on Parents and Children, and you can see a good example. So let's start with a good example, and then we can be sad. Or should we be sad first and then happy? What do you think? Let's be sad first so that we're going somewhere happy. See, I'm structuring my teaching in a linear way. Your op-ed should literally map to this DNA that I gave you, the skeleton, right? Like a house that you're building, and I've used this metaphor before. I'm always going to use it. You open the door, you enter the hallway, that's the introduction. The transition is going from room to room. You transition into the living room. That's your first paragraph. What's in the living room? You tell people what that's about. You go into the hall and transition into the bed, into the dining room. Second paragraph, what's happening in the dining room? You transition into the scullery. And then when you're done, you conclude by leaving the house and looking at it and saying what it looks like. You know, what describing the journey that you've just been on, or pointing to what happens next. So if you can map whatever you're writing to that structure, whatever you're writing is going to sound logical, because you're building an argument, right? The thing about mapping your op-ed to that structure, too, is that it forces you to get rid of redundancy. Because often you'll circle around and circle around if you're not writing to a structure. And if you are going, if you've got this structure, then you think, huh, this first paragraph is about families being rounded up, but it's got a sentence about Trump's executive order, but I go into the executive order in the third paragraph, that really belongs in the third paragraph. Or you'll see that you addressed the executive order twice, right? And you'll cut one. But the other thing it forces you to do, and this is why I love it so much, is that it actually forces you to think, and transitions are so important. Does this lead to that? Does this lead to that? Does it really? Does it lead to that? Have I done enough telling people what's in the living room that I can now leave the living room and logically go into the dining room, right? So what you'll find is that in writing, oh God, I'm so awful because I just say things that nobody wants to hear. But on the other hand, I'm a highly successful writer, so it must work. And I've taught people successfully for many years, so it works. Many new writers or unprofessional writers think that the first draft is the essay. But the essay is in the revision, right? The first draft is just your raw material. It's just like, blah, you know, you just barf it out there, right? That's the wrong metaphor, sorry. It's just clay that you've created with a rough shape. And then the actual writing is the sculpting and the sculpting, to mix metaphors here. So I got an essay from a young writer, and it was clearly a first draft. And she wanted me to tell her, you know, what to do. This is a little different from not writing a long enough piece. This is writing an unedited piece, right? You need to be your own editor first. And I said, you know, I don't want you to send this to me until you've stared at it, you know, and revised, and stared at it and revised. You need to kind of go into the intellectual space of your essay or your nonfiction book and live there, right? And look around and think, am I comfortable here? Do I know where I'm going? Am I making sense? And then does every single sentence make sense and lead in a linear way? So let's look at this very nice op-ed. I love it so much. It's, you know, it's not literally 1, 2, 3 main paragraphs. But it follows, and again, once you've mastered this structure, you can expand or contract it. So you don't have to take the 3 paragraphs literally. But Professor Heemstra, who impressively didn't use her Dr. Heemstra, you can if you want to, that's her bio, she starts out right in what theater calls in medias res, in the middle of an exciting event or an impactful event, this declaration that a branch of the United States government would be rounding up Central American immigrants for deportation. And then her language, remember what I said last time I was here about Anglo-Saxon language? It's not an ethnic or racial note, it's a linguistic one. Anglo-Saxon language being sharper and clearer than Latinate language, right? So she said, listen to the rhythm. This past weekend, the raids began with parents and children being detained in military-style operations in several southern and border states. Fear has spread through immigrant communities around the country. Boom, right? You can hear the music. It's martial music. Da-dun, da-dun, da-dun. The footsteps are coming, the knock on the door. The language is Anglo-Saxon. She's using very simple, direct words this past weekend, not recently. It has been reported that, right? Passive, distanced. The raids began with parents and children. She's personalizing it, not, you know, immigrant families, parents and children, right? That's so much more vivid than immigrant families being detained in military style operations. So she's invoking a vivid image in several southern and border states. Ideally there, I'd like her to be even more concrete and specific and name a couple of them. Fear has spread through immigrant communities around the country. It's emotional, right? Fear is a thing that your amygdala, the reptile brain, hears and reacts to. It's a hook, right? She's hooked you. Wow, I better keep reading. There are 1,000 ways she could have written a much more boring first paragraph and lost the reader. So your first paragraph is very critical. You want to use emotion, or you want to use a vivid event, or you want to use a time-sensitive news hook, an urgent situation to force that reader to keep reading. Or you can use other tricks. Like I will often, and it's not bad to say these are tricks, I will often reach out for the contrarian thing. Like many people think X, but in fact Y. You know, you'd be surprised to know that Y. But let's go on. So then she establishes her credibility. She's a professor of immigration studies, but she also says who she is, which I love. I'm also an Anglo mom of two on Long Island, and I speak Spanish, so I talk with Latino immigrants. I listen, I ask. And this is what fear looks like in my town. Ugh, I just love, I love people taking this kind of guidance and applying it to their own expertise, because how powerful. You know, she's saying, I'm not just a credible authority here at this university, I'm also a mom and I'm talking to my neighbors. So there's that drama that, you know, I'm bringing you into my town and into my home, and people around me are scared. And it's starting to feel kind of like one of those horror movies that, you know, it's a picture-perfect community, but the zombies are, you know, surfacing, right? You this sense of doom, right? Then she gets even more granular. I love it. Sunday afternoon, my kids were playing with some kids in the community, and then she tells a story. Remember last time I was here, I talked about storytelling versus abstraction, right? You lose the readers by saying, and she could have said, you know, multiple sources report that on Long Island, children are expressing anxiety to their teachers and administrators. She could have written that sentence. You'd be like, I'm sorry, but I really want to turn the page now. But instead, she tells a story about a little boy saying, Miss Nancy, which is already so moving. And this little boy saying, my mom was crying, she's so scared, and then she calls his mother, right? It's a story, and she tells the background of this woman, and she tells the background of the children. So at this point, by the third paragraph, we're caring about Nancy, we're caring about the kid, and we're caring about his mom and the family. And then we want to read further. So she's using transitions very well. And again, transitions are deeply underutilized and understood. People just kind of move chunkily and randomly from paragraph to paragraph. She's told this horrible story, and then she transitions with, according to local media reports, no raids have actually occurred on Long Island yet, but ICE's actions in other states have fueled rapidly spreading rumors. So she's now pulling back, looking at the big picture, and saying, I'm transitioning from this little child to what's the actual status politically and in terms of governance about these raids. And she gives some authoritative information about DHS, and then she does another nice transition. She's told you what the raids are, right? Remember I said who, what, where, why, and how. By this point we know who, these kids and these families, and Nancy Heemstra, Professor Heemstra, what the raids, why kind of unclear, but that's part of the power of the piece. It's like, why are they rounding them up? A good thing to do to make sure you don't get criticism on this is to say, if you really hate the raids, you could say, supporters of the policy say da-da-da-da. So you've dealt with that, but then you can transition, say, however, critics think this is way too much. And then transition to back into being a critic, right? But at least you've given the semblance of knowing what the other side says about this, or the why. Where on Long Island and how in this dramatic military-style set of raids. So a really good transitional sentence is these raids don't just create fear, they create barriers, right? She's talked about fear. This is a great transitional sentence. Transitional sentences are, they can come in many forms. This is not just this, but also that, right? So she's gestured at the last paragraph, she gestured at the living room. They don't just create fear, they also create barriers. Now we go into another room and we talk about barriers, right? She's too scared to continue her education. Exposition, exposition, exposition. Then back to the DHS. And then she does something very clever here, which I love, which is she does first, second, third. She creates a dichotomy here. DHS secretary says these raids are necessary, so this is the what do critics say. This is what, you know, the why. And then she rebuts him, boom, 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 right? And we're totally hooked now, so we're watching her let poor DHS Jed Johnson, is that his name? Jed Johnson, into the boxing ring with Professor Heemstra. There he is, walking in saying, well, these raids are necessary. And then she's like, boom, first of all, boom, second of all, and boom, third of all. And by the time she's done, he is flat out on the floor, according to the reader's sympathies, or at least she's made a very powerful rhetorical assault on his reasoning. So first, the strategy doesn't work. It's not effective. Exposition. Second, detaining and deporting immigrants is big business. So I would push that transition there a little harder to make it even more dramatic. Second, you're not really saying, there are buried truths, she said. So she's introed it with buried truths. But I would move the buried truths down to second. Second, there's a secret behind this supposedly altruistic or, you know, noble policy or whatever they're calling it, necessary security measure, which is people are making buckets of money off of it, right? It's big business. And then exposition, she gives the numbers. Exposition, 34,000 per day quota. Exposition, I'd like to see the $340 a day figure in here, like more, a little more numbers. To show us, oh my God, they're saying we're in danger from these families, but in fact, people are making money out of it. That's a whole, so she's done something that I taught you about in media training, where she's moved the spotlight, right? She's moved it in that second clause away from the rhetorical frame of, well, we need to round up these people because, why does Jed Johnson say we need to round them up? Are necessary to deter new migration. So she's like pushed that frame of rhetoric right over to, well, really, is it about deterring migration or is it about Jed Johnson's friends, you know, who are invested in private security companies and making $340 per night per person, $1,400 per night for a family of four. Dramatic piece of evidence. And third, And here I'd like a slightly stronger transition. The violence in chaos reigning in Central America is a direct result of U.S. policies. So that's, I just did an interview with Professor Heemstra, and that's probably, she's packed a lot into that third paragraph, right? It's a big assertion. I'm not saying she can't make it, but it's one of those assertions that right-wingers or you know, libertarians will say, we'll stop listening at that point because, like, oh, right, it's our fault, you know. And I pushed Professor Heemstra quite hard because I know my own community, which is very diverse, many points of view, not just on the left. Actually, Daily Cloud is transpartisan, would say, well, they're not obeying the law. That was one issue that hasn't really been dealt with in this piece. It, you know, you could do a whole other piece about that. But the other thing they would say is, really? It's our fault, and even if it's our fault, does that mean we just have to open the doors? So it's a big leap. I think you can make big leaps. I think she's perfectly entitled to say this. It's a gutsy move, and I also want to give her credit because women, unfortunately, tend to be more careful and not make those sweeping claims. I've made a career out of making sweeping claims, so I respect it a lot. But then I would encourage you to, you would need more space to walk me through the reason that our pushing gang members down there in the 80s resulted in, you know, violence up here. And also she'd have to persuade me with a sentence that philosophically that's a good way to do foreign policy or immigration policy is, well, we were stupid 30 years ago, so now it's our responsibility. I'm open to it, but, you know, I'd want a little bit more exposition there. So, and then the last sentence, but, you know, it's three great, I mean, it's done enough to, you know, with like a defense of a criminal or someone accused of a crime, you don't need to prove that they're innocent. You need to raise a reasonable doubt. So even if I'm not persuaded 100% by every single thing that Dr. Heemstra has said here, she has raised plenty of doubt in my mind that this is the best policy. Like, maybe I'm not with her that we just, whatever, open the borders, you know, but I'm certainly persuaded that this way that it's being done has some problems or demands more scrutiny. So be open to that as a victory, right? Like, if all you do is get people to think about an issue they think they understand or have settled an opinion about in a new way and process the evidence that you're bringing to them, you've succeeded, right? Because social change is slow and complicated, and people need facts and multiple points of view in order to think well. So Nancy doesn't have to, you know, have 100 people, all the 100% of people sitting in this room say, I'm signed on for Nancy's policy on immigration, right? She has done her job by, you know, winning over those people who are ready to be won over and giving substance to doubts or concerns that she's raising about this being the way to go. So then she wraps it up and she says, so the current Detain and Deport initiative won't stop the immigration we are largely responsible for. Now I love this because now she's like doubling down on the rhetoric of it's our fault. I mean, I love it because she's not backing down. But it will make healthy profits for those banking on it. So now she's like, he's on the floor, right? She's like stomping on his face at this point. I mean, I don't want to use a violent metaphor, but it's like, and it kills immigrants and their children's attempts to become part of the local communities. So now she's like so in her own rhetorical space now. In my town, immigrant parents aren't walking their kids to the school bus stop, shutters are drawn, life feels on hold, right? This is not a good thing, right? You'd have to be a monster to think this is a good thing, whatever your point of view. These raids don't just impact immigrants who have sought refuge in the US in the last year or two, they terrorize families across the country, ensuring that they can never really arrive. Again, beautiful writing. Even if they have been here for decades, even if kids and spouses are citizens, even if they want nothing more than to settle in and build a life. So you, in the conclusion, what you want is music, you know, and you want to stir up emotion, right, as well as to sum up what the position is that you want to leave your readers with. So she's looked back, she said, this is what I've said, this is what I believe, boom, 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 right, the conclusion, it's a little, I don't want to say formulaic, but she's like, and I approve of that, especially if you're just starting out, right? It's like learning scales. You can do that. You can touch the main points of everything you just said, and then, as she did, wrap it up in a beautiful rhetorical bow. You heard the music of those last few sentences. Da-da-da-da-da, even if they're just da-da-da, da-da-da-da, right? Like, boom, right? It's like the end of a beautiful movie or an action film. It leaves on music. And there are other tricks that you can use. For a conclusion, you can point to the future, right? You can sound elegiac. This was a little bit elegiac, but it's like regret or mourning, you know, especially if you're writing a piece about something having gone wrong. You can invoke a noble sentiment like patriotism or mother love, or, you know, it's a little bit cheap to do this because it always works, but, you know, if there's some sentiment that you can call on, I mean, I've got a candidate who's running for Congress in as a Republican. He's a veteran. He's running in North Carolina. And, you know, when I was writing about him and his platform, you know, he tells this story of this veteran lying on the floor in the VA hospital, an older guy waiting to get help, you know, because the beds were all taken. And so a great way for him to end an op-ed about his run, why he's running to serve veterans in his community, would be elegiac, like so that this guy who served his country will never have to lie on the floor, you know, in this state again. Like, or, you know, stirring, you know, we've sent these men and women into battle, now let's, you know, do battle on their behalf, right? Like, different kinds of music, different kinds of, you know, wrapping it up and looking both backwards and forwards. So that's how you write your op-ed. And we've just gone through that. So now, does anyone have any questions about what I just said before I quickly show you bad writing, and then we get to actually hearing your own pitches and then giving you time to do a little bit of writing? And by the way, all of you have this Daily Clout style guide. So it's not a general style guide. It's that one right there. Thank you. It's specific to my website and my blog. So ignore the part about how you talk about legislation, because our blog is focused on legislation. But everything else about good writing and how you cite, you know, other sources, or how you cite data, or what's credible sourcing, all of that is good information for you and applicable.
Yeah, you know, I'm used to writing the academic paper, you have, you know, in-text sort of citations, those sort of things. Of course, I shouldn't have that here, but even the quote 34,000 deaths per day, I don't think she necessarily cites that per se. So is that going to help? I mean, how do you?
My name is Thomas Woodson. So I'm used to doing academic writing. We do in-text citations. In this paper, great writing, but she doesn't have an in-text citation. So how do we deal with that citation? You just say the New York Times said?
That's a great question. And there are several ways to do it that are correct for popular journalism. The one I like best is, as the New York Times reported, you know, and then recently, if it's recently, and if it's not recently, you'd have to say in 2014. You don't give the whole date, March 14th, 2014. And then you summarize what they reported, or you use a quote, and then you hyperlink, right? You embed the actual second source or primary source in the text itself. And a good rule of thumb is that you should, for a 800 to 1200 word piece, use 2 to 3 hyperlinks, right? And a great thing to hyperlink is, and by the way, millennials, God bless them, I don't mean to single them out, but they always want to make you click on the link in order to find out what's in it. And you actually should treat those links as proof rather than as somewhere that you're making your reader go. So you really need to do the work of lifting out, you know, we had a piece about diabetes, a blog about, and go to dailyclout.io and take a look at the blog posts. Most of them are not op-eds, but there are some op-eds, but you'll see how to cite. But, you know, there was one about a Maine bill that gives preventive care for diabetes, and we cited a Health and Human Services report that there are 130,000 people with diabetes in the state of Maine. So instead of saying the diabetes rate is very high in Maine and then hyperlinking, which is what my millennials always want to do, you have to say, as the Department of Health and Human Services reported in 2015, there are 130,000 people with diabetes in Maine, then embed the link, right? And then if you're sending it in a Word document to your editor, obviously you don't have a blog, you're not going to embed the hyperlink yourself. You just cut and paste the URL and put it in a bracket, and then they'll embed it. Am I speaking language everyone understands probably better than I do, right? Does that answer your question? Yeah, thank you.
That embedded URL would just be right after the text, like, so you would hyperlink, you know, let's say a quote at the end of whatever you're saying, you would just put it in parentheses after that section?
Brackets.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, when you're sending it to your editor for their website, that's what you do, or obviously for print, and then they'll format it. But if you're doing it yourself with your own blog, you can embed it yourself. Yeah. Did you have a, you're just carrying the, okay, carrying the mic. Yeah.
If information is easily findable and well known enough, is it okay to not hyperlink or
is that? If everybody knows that President Trump was just elected President of the United States, you don't need to source that. No, seriously. Yeah, if everyone knows it. But ask yourself always, if everyone you know knows it, it doesn't mean that everyone knows it. Like, I'm always making people ID, which means identify, something that they think everybody knows, especially with technology. Like, you know, someone will write RSS feed and I'll be like, explain what that is, right? Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
I would just say as a... Hi, I'm Ryan Hunter. I'm a history major, a graduate student here. I would say, as someone who's not a specialist in immigration policy or studies, the only part of this op-ed that confused me even momentarily was the 34,000 per day bed quota, because I didn't initially realize, okay, you're talking about at detention centers, right?
Oh, right.
So that's like the only thing I thought.
Yeah, so that would be good to put a hyperlink.
Yeah, or even just to, I guess, use the word detention center, but I think especially at the beginning, your use of active verbs and nouns like fear, detain, and again, how you structure that throughout your piece, it was extremely effective on an emotional level.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think that even though you very artfully go through and you don't mention specific administration policies previously, nor do you make it like a partisan issue.
Right.
I think that actually broadens your appeal immensely.
So well done. And I didn't mean to, thank you. Let me encourage us to, because I kind of used Professor Heemstra's essay without clearing it with her first. So let's not deconstruct her essay critically any further, unless she gives us permission, but thank you. But what I'd like to do maybe now is show you a bad piece of writing or an unpublishable piece of writing, so you can see the difference, right? And I also want to really give you all a shout out, because as these seminars have progressed, it's so satisfying. I'm hearing people say, like you just did, I'm sorry, what was your name again?
Oh, Ryan.
Ryan, you know, I'm hearing people say in more clearly, in a more direct voice, more kind of camera ready, you know, microphone ready, I'm this and I do that and here's my statement or here's my question. And this is great practice because, you know, in everything we're doing, like we're in a public space, even though it's kind of also private, every opportunity we get, you know, you're practicing being ready, you know, you're practicing for your close-up. And the other thing I've said before, and I'll say it again, is even in a space like this, if you're thinking of yourself always as a public figure, you know that even while we're exploring and asking questions and hammering things out, we're also projecting who we are in case there's someone else in the room who can help us, advance us, promote us, come to us with you know, assistance for our advocacy. I've been teaching writing for 25 years. And literally every time I push a writer to go behind what their mission is or their work is, something happened to them, right? It doesn't have to be tragic, but often there's something, some deficit, some loss, some displacement, some alienation, maybe not just to them, maybe to their family, and it's part of the family heritage, right? And that's what draws them. So honor that, right? Honor that and don't hide it. Like, you don't have to say, well, I write about substance abuse because I'm an adult child of alcoholics. You can if you want. I would encourage you to, frankly. But, you know for yourself where that comes from, because then you can really open your heart and empathize and be present with your language, you know, the way that you're so present with these kids and adults. All right. So we've done good and bad writing. So now let's, does anyone have questions about what I just said? Yes, please.
The topic that you mentioned.
So I want you to hold the mic closer to your mouth, please. Thank you. Wonderful. And just project your voice toward me a little.
Okay. I have a question about topics that are maybe less emotional, like the one you used about hipsters and puppies.
Yes.
What would be the way to like argue for something, and like what kind of emotions we can appeal to?
So, sir, you can turn the video back on. I'm just letting you know that we're back on. So, well, it's up to you. I mean, some essays don't need deep, painful emotions or deep emotions at all. I wrote a piece about changing my hair color. I may have used this as an example before. For Cosmo, I lightened my hair. And then, of course, I'm a feminist cultural critic, so I had a lot of thoughts about that, you know, and about the different ways that people treated me when I was brunette versus with lighter hair. And that's not, it wasn't deep emotion that went into that piece at all. It was just curiosity and social analysis. So the emotion is up to you. But there, I mean, I talked about deep emotion because the piece we just read was about a tragic, traumatic situation, refugees. And Dr. Heemster's piece was about refugees. But you don't need to go into deep, tragic emotion if you're not writing about a tragic thing. So if I were writing about hipsters with puppies, I'm really interested, as the mother of a son and a daughter, in how boys growing up today have more access to being able to express emotions that in my childhood men were not considered manly in expressing, like, oh, how cute, you know, publicly. And I would speculate about being raised by single mothers or raised by feminists or, evolving models of masculinity. And I would cite, you know, action films and a couple of other examples of surprisingly, like Sherlock, you know, or, you know, surprisingly sort of literate or poetic action heroes, you know, or male masculinity heroes. And then I would say, well, this is a trend, right? And I just go a little deeper. But that's really more curiosity and analysis than emotion. Yeah. Does that answer your question? Yeah. Yeah.
I'm John Canley from psychology. I'm a professor in the Department of Psychology. So question or maybe an observation. One way, when you were reading your first paragraph of the bad example, it sounded to me like this was something somebody could have copied out of Wikipedia or something like that. Yeah. It sounded very generic.
Yes.
And maybe one way to think about drafting an op-ed is to figure out what would be my unique voice? What is it that only I can say, nobody else, and then kind of hone that? What do you think about that as an approach to?
I mean, I think that's great. I would say flip it around, that when you really are writing to share your expertise or your mission or your feeling or whatever your subject is, and you're writing clearly in an organized way, your natural voice will emerge naturally. And I wouldn't belabor it. You know, I think all you need to do to let your natural voice emerge is to give yourself permission to not use jargon, give yourself permission to be honest. And the best advice I was ever given, which I may have shared, which is write this letter to your best friend, Dear John, or your best reader, write your piece, and then delete Dear John, and that's your first draft. You know, imagining that ideal reader, that sympathetic reader, that you just are excited to share things with. Every time I feel frozen with an essay, I make myself think, why am I excited to share this? And then I just kind of go back into that excitement to share. Like, there was a baby who's two that I heard about, and this is the illustrating point about excitement to share. And she isn't talking yet, but she's using a lot of sign language. Like, she can hear perfectly. There's nothing wrong with her development, but she's just not ready to talk. And her friend brought a big whale to her class, and she loved the big whale, and she makes whale sounds, and so she was excited to share with her grandmother that she saw this big stuffed whale in kindergarten or preschool or whatever, and so she went, she made whale sounds, and then she went like that, so big, you know. So the desire to share something that excites you or that intrigues you, go to that childlike level of human excitement to communicate, right? And then you cannot go wrong with the motivation. Now let's go to you guys, okay, with the time we have, quickly. I want to hear what people are working on, and then I want you, or maybe just right out of the gate, I want you to pitch it to me as if I'm an editor and you want me to commission your op-ed. Yeah. Whoever goes first. And let me encourage you too, if you want to be public intellectuals, at a moment like this, go first, whether you're ready to or not. It's very important for you to get used to thinking on your feet, and over, even if it's not perfect, and also overcoming natural inhibitions and acclimating your brain, which is plastic, to being that person who just says, sure, I'll try it, right? I'll go. Yeah, please.
Hi, I'm Sarah Azara, and I teach for Writing and Rhetoric in the Honors College.
Hi, Sarah. Good to see you again.
Good to see you. The piece I'm working on is a modern love style piece, so I hope this is useful.
Don't apologize. Just go right into it. I want to work on a modern love style piece.
I want to work on a modern love style piece framing it a bit around social media, involving also the newspaper industry and the decline of print work and how it leads to artistic crisis.
It's getting a little abstract. Okay. I'm kind of lost. Are you saying you want, is it about love?
I want to tell a love story.
Wonderful, which is what?
22 years ago, I fell in love with a brilliant writer. Didn't work out.
So this is a short essay. So what's this essay going to say about this writer you fell in love with and this issue?
I got another chance.
Oh.
He had trouble getting work as a writer, and he killed himself.
I'm so sorry.
And I'm trying to frame it in terms of how things are changed.
With the pitch, you don't tell the editor what you're trying to do. You just want to tell me what it is and why it matters.
Starts with Facebook changing everything.
So Facebook changed everything. So I want to write a piece about how Facebook changed everything, especially around love, right? And I'll use an example of this man I fell in love with long ago who killed himself and how I got a second chance using technology. Is that correct?
Yes.
That's all you need to say.
Okay.
And then it's like, wow, tell me more. And when you get the tell me more, that's when you get to tease out the piece a little bit.
Okay.
But that was a great, did you all hear the difference? Wonderful. Good, good. Congratulate her. Applause. Excellent. Excellent. And I really want to shout out to you and to a number of people because I see some familiar faces and I see people using what you're learning and building your skill sets in being public intellectuals. It's dramatic. So I applaud that. All right, next person. How will you pitch NotBed to me and tell me what it is you're working on? Yeah.
I'll go. I would want to say to Sarah, I was so surprised by what you just said, that I really hope you write that.
Well, that's wonderful. You really need to write it. Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and I guess everyone's also asking, like, can you tell me in a sentence how you got a second chance?
Facebook, and he posted something. I could tell something was wrong. I reached out. We started talking.
So this is another person, not the first.
No, it's the same person. Same,
but he killed himself?
22, yeah.
Oh, I get it. Oh, dear. All right, a tragic love story, but a second chance. Okay, so then what you would need to do is draw a lesson or an argument from it. Like, you could start out saying, like, it's become a cliche that people can find long-lost loves now that Facebook exists. Well, I'm here to point out that technology doesn't solve some human tragedies. That could be a way to frame it as an argument, and then tell the story. Good, yes.
Okay. So I have an idea for a center that I want to start up that works to improve Russian-American relations in the wake of this election and all of the craziness and lack of predictability about US foreign policy toward Russia, and also Russia's uncertainty of how to react to the election and everything that it implies.
Mm-hmm. So tell me about an op-ed you'd want to write based on this issue.
So what I've noticed is among the intelligence community, among the foreign policy community, and among all real stakeholders on this issue, there's a lack of willingness to take action now on this.
Okay.
And it's urgent because Russia has the largest nuclear stockpile in the
world. So take action is one of the slightly vague phrases.
Okay.
I'm listening, but I'm not sure what you're saying. What do you want them to do?
Most Russians and most Americans don't talk to each other.
Okay.
We have no real way to do so.
Okay.
Unless we have personal connections. I do, and I see kind of on a citizen diplomacy level, what that can do in improving understanding of each other.
All right, so are you saying, I want to write a piece about the following. It's a moment of high tension between Russia and the United States. Mm-hmm. Example, the election, the accusations of treason, the accusations of bribery, the interference in the election, and something from the Russian point of view that we're doing wrong. This could really spit out of control.
Right.
People in the intelligence and diplomacy world are worried about it spinning out of control. I have a solution, which is citizen-to-citizen contact, and I have personal experience of how well that works, and I'll give examples. Is that what you're saying?
Excellent. That's so much better. That is so much better.
It's a great subject. So yeah. What would be, give me quickly like one or two examples.
Sure.
Because if I'm your editor, I'm like, give me an example.
Okay.
And you have to do it on your feet.
Right. So the first would be to arrange panels where Russians and Americans actually talk to each other.
Okay.
Which you can do through...
And you mean Russians in Russia, like make that clear. Like it's
not
in Brooklyn. Right?
But part of it actually is in Brooklyn. So
okay.
Part of it is that just like a lot of undocumented immigrants now are feeling a lot of horror and confusion because of the ICE enforcement of this latest executive order, a lot of Russians, because of the ratcheted tensions that are living here, are sort of like, do we leave, do we stay?
Wow.
So there's a sense of dislocation, and there's also
okay,
a sense
okay, now you're getting
of,
a little worry,
okay.
wordy. So
okay.
Russians are worried. I get it.
Okay.
So what do you want to do?
I think there's a need for us to start talking to each other.
Awesome. So what's an example of how?
So on an academic level, you could have seminars, but on just simply a person-to-person level, there are leaders in the Russian community, both here in the United States, and then there are citizen diplomats from the end of the Cold War era in Russia who are wanting to do this and wanting to have a conversation.
How very interesting. So a useful thing, tell me your name again.
Ryan.
Ryan would do, you know, people can't hear in print or verbally a run-on, like they lose focus. And they're also, it's anxiety creating to read or hear a run-on because you don't know where it's going to end. So you don't know if you're lost or if you've lost something. People really have to hear and see your punctuation. So you gave two great examples, and you should do what she did, which is, well, first, academics can have panels. But second, use former diplomats on both sides, I assume
yeah.
you mean, to talk and then tell me what technology they would use.
Okay.
And third, ordinary citizens can reach out by using whatever medium. Am I missing
no,
an idea?
No, that's, again, you're saying it wonderfully, so.
Fantastic,
yeah.
And this is so great. And then my question would be, and what kind of mechanism would fund that or organize it?
Sure. So there are tons of foundations, both in Russia and here, that have expressed an interest in doing so. But there hasn't really been the groundwork yet in terms of a meeting of minds.
So again, groundwork and meeting of minds, passive voice, abstract,
okay.
don't know who. So you want to say there are leaders in both sides who are standing by to do it. There's money from foundations, but it takes, I don't know what.
Well, it takes people, first off, getting interested stakeholders in the same room together.
I hate the phrase interested stakeholders.
Okay.
I mean, I know it's good.
Yeah.
You know, intelligence community or
right.
business
so
jargon, but
I guess
who
the
are
way
they?
Of rephrasing it would be it takes leaders in different communities, both in Russia and the United States, to have a sense that they can talk to each other.
So you're describing it really well, but what do you propose? Like your op-ed has to propose a solution or propose a way out.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that would be bringing.
Or say you guys do this, right? Sorry.
Yeah. So that would be then bringing together Russian and American.
Bringing who? Gerund. Don't use gerunds.
Okay.
Okay. Who brings it together? Who do you want to have do this? And here you need
yeah.
to go out on a limb. Like you need to say, well, I think X should do it. The State Department, you know, who?
Okay. Well, I would say I think the State Department should do it and the Russian right. Foreign Ministry.
Awesome. Do you hear the difference when he actually kind of spits out who he thinks? And it's like it's a gutsy, bold move. Like he wants to tell the State Department what to do and the Russian Foreign Ministry. And why not? Like that's your, you're entitled. And it may be an awesome idea.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
But my reservation was I didn't want to come off as saying that. But you're saying I should.
You need to say that.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, unless you're afraid they'll assassinate you, you really do need to say who would do that.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
And it's not the first time. Like the State Department used to have, they used to fund initiatives for people
yes.
to connect. And then you would use some examples in the 50s and the 60s, you know,
of
Voice of America,
successful.
Et cetera. Yes.
Okay.
Yes. That's fantastic. And so what's your call to action?
So my call to action would be that, you know, what, in other words, what I want them to do.
What do you want your readers to do? you know, if you think this is a good idea, how do you get behind it?
Contact your representative in Congress and write to the State Department and begin to say that you want this to happen.
This is wonderful. So I would say name the initiative that you want. Like, just throw out a name. Like
the Center for...
But don't call it a center.
Okay.
Because it's not just a physical place. You want these things to happen in cyberspace. And or are you saying that you want the federal government to fund Russian-American outreach?
Eventually, yeah.
In a department? So you need to do a little digging and think, well, who's set up to do this, right? Because the State Department, you know, and spies, basically, are set up to, you know, do this kind of cultural exchange.
Right.
I shouldn't say spies. Things that in the 50s and 60s later turned out to be fronts for intelligence. You know, also did very important work with U.S.-Soviet relations culturally. But yeah, you would just need to say, well, who does it and how does the State Department do it? And then what you would need to do is lobby the Secretary of State, right? Or lobby the President to set up something through the Secretary of State, or lobby Congress to set up something, if I understand it correctly. Who makes, I'm not sure, you need to dig into like who does these exchanges, because I'm not sure.
The State Department.
It is the State Department. All right, well then you do it perfect. So say the State Department, use examples.
Sure.
And say, also do some research to say how much it would cost. It's a, you know, $5 million initiative, drop in the bucket compared to the hostility and the way it could spin us into World War III. Right?
Yeah.
Perfect, brilliant. That's a really awesome idea. And you should write it. That's a fabulous op-ed. I love it. It's so persuasive. All right, who else wants to do it? Yeah. Please.
Hello.
Hi.
I'm Jeremy. I'm working on a project to build gardens at schools.
Oh, awesome.
So the idea is...
And so public schools, private schools?
Every school, anywhere there's public space. So if counties and taxpayers are paying for the upkeep of grounds, for instance, if you look outside right now, all that space right there can grow corn and weed and all these different kind of things. So it's not a new idea as much.
So let me stop you.
Go ahead.
It's a great idea, but I'm having to work to lift out the substance of it. So what you might want to rephrase is, you're working on a what, is it? It's a project?
On an initiative. So
is it a nonprofit? Is it a, you want the municipality to pass a law?
It can be as far as public policy and trying to get new laws enacted and new spending protocols and such, but it could be as simple as getting you to go home and build a garden in your yard.
Okay, so you're it's an awareness campaign. Which
awareness campaign and policy.
And with a policy
everything
arm.
All
okay, so you that's your what, and you also want to say to take public green space that's kind of wasted in terms of growing wonderful fruits and vegetables and flowers, right? And turning those into community gardens, is that correct?
Yeah.
All right, so say that.
Okay.
Or in your own words.
Well, taking space that is otherwise unused and putting it to produce food so we could start addressing issues of hunger on Long Island.
So urban gardens and suburban gardens?
Urban gardens, suburban, yeah.
Community gardens? Like
anywhere, it can go everywhere.
Who owns the gardens?
So it would be wherever they are. So like Suffolk County might start by just focusing on Suffolk County and Nassau County. Manhattan is kind of a different thing.
But then who owns the gardens?
It's not an issue of ownership as much. Whoever owns the property or maintains the property in the first place continues to maintain the property. It'd almost be like subletting their property, which is being unused, into an initiative where volunteers can come in and work, or there could be a framework for it. So I'd love it to just go to vets and students. I think that's the place to start.
This is a great first draft. It's a fabulous first draft. He's thinking about, and it's, again, these are wonderful ideas. Like, I mean, seriously, in this room alone, it's like we're solving the Russia-America problem. We're solving hunger on Long Island. It's awesome, awesome ideas. And all they take is a little pushing, right, to get structure and detail. So your first draft, what you would want to do is find out, start small, start with, you know, one county, right? And say, well, I'm starting an initiative that can grow statewide, but we're starting with Suffolk County for awareness and a lobbying arm to change public policy so that a lot of acres of unused green space can be turned into community gardens. Boom. And then you need to do a little bit of thinking about how you allocate that, because public-private space is a deeply important, I'm obsessed with it, it's a very important issue. I love your idea, but there is a difference between a community garden in someone's backyard and the laws around that versus the fantastic idea of taking like some acres that are being devoted to grass here at Stony Brook University and creating a community garden. And then you want to work out, well, how would I suggest allocating?
I have.
All right.
So the idea is this. So, awesome. You know, so Stony Brook would, I started at Suffolk Community College.
You when started I was, a community garden.
Yes.
This is called burying the lead. The most important thing he has to share with us is that he has experience doing this successfully. So your second paragraph, after you've introduced this idea, is something like, you might be surprised to learn that I successfully started a community garden like this at Suffolk County Community College. Go ahead, exposition. What happened to it? What did it
so
grow?
What we did over there is the students were responsible for interacting with the garden, getting things planted and everything like that. An issue that we ran into is a lack of expertise. There is that conflict of public space.
So don't lead with the problem with the idea, right?
Okay.
Let people worry about that or bury it further down. You know, a challenge can be training, right?
Okay.
So we'd want to build in training. But tell me successfully what happened.
So we were able to grow a bunch of food and
donate
it to...
Do you see how I'm pushing him to be more concrete, more specific, more concrete? What was the food?
We grew corn, tomatoes, beans, dry beans, wet beans. We were able to grow beets, chamomile. There were a lot of Long Island native plants that we were able to grow because its objective is not just to produce food for people in need, but also to create areas of biodiversity to help
Love
the bumblebees.
It's a fantastic idea. So these are all amazing ideas. You tell me your name again.
Jeremy
is doing a bit of a run-on the way Ryan was doing a bit of a run-on. So when you're doing it again or you're doing it at your computer, you'd be like semicolon. So, you know, we grew seven types of produce primarily. Corn, tomatoes, boom, boom, boom. In addition, we cared about biodiversity. So we also had native flowers like boom, boom, boom. Go ahead. Do you hear the difference that makes in not mushing it together? Yeah.
Yeah, so in overcoming the training issues, the idea is to centralize
How many
it.
Students worked at Suffolk County?
So we were able to grow the largest student club in the last half of the semester that we started it. We were able to host the largest student activity, which mm-hmm. had the greatest participation on a non-school day.
So you're using awesome... sort of biggest, largest, ideally you'd say 70 students participated in the program over the course of 4 years. It became the most popular student activities option, and by the end of it, we had raised 2 tons of food for 100 families in Long Island. Do you see what I'm saying, doing there? Like, just what are the numbers? Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
The idea is just to...
So what happened to that garden? Is it still
alive? It's still going now.
Wow.
So a couple students took it over after I left from that school and came here.
So this is detail that's too granular. We don't need to worry about
okay.
that. But tell me how you allocated the food. How did you decide who gets the food?
So we just met amongst the students who were participating in the garden. We had a couple of aged vets. For me personally, it was an important issue because I grew up kind of poor. So
this is getting a little discursive.
Okay.
So I literally just want to know, like, what did the bylaws say or what did the policy say about who gets the produce and how did you distribute it?
So there's limits to that. Giving it directly to students is perfectly allowed, but if we cut it, we're not allowed to because then you deal with the Board of Health and everything like that. So the idea was to just give raw produce.
So you gave
to
raw
everybody.
Produce to students.
Yes.
That's a good thing right there to start with, right? Students are, you know, this is a public university. Vegetables are expensive. That's great. So be proud of that. Like we delivered, you know, 300 pounds of food to students on campus so they could have fresh fruit and vegetables, right? But going forward, we'd like our initiative to distribute produce to what, veterans and what, children?
Homeless veterans and students, K-12 and possibly college.
Okay, so that's good. Keep it tight and specific. We started with students. That was successful. We're expanding it now to veterans and to students K-12. Through, and then you need to figure out what mechanism, just like he needs to figure out what mechanism. Fabulous. Then the other research piece you need for this wonderful essay, fantastic idea, amazing idea, is to do a little research into how much open space is available, I would say, just on
92
public.
Million acres of aggregable rooftop in Manhattan. Suffolk County is vastly larger than that. There's over a million schools nationwide.
So again, like, what's that topic sentence? Like, well, surprisingly, is a great transition, there are you know, 9,500 acres or whatever of space on the public schools of Suffolk County, right? Be as specific as you can, and don't start out everywhere. Start out with a thing that is going to waste. You know, with X amount of investment, you need to crunch the numbers, even if hypothetical, we can do what? Put dirt over all of them and grow stuff? Is that the mechanism? You tell me.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Is that the mechanism?
We have the sun, we have the water. We just need to put dirt and seeds.
So is rooftops the best acreage to use right away?
Well, that would apply only in the Manhattan district. So it kind
so
of
So let's
focus.
Just talk about sure. this area, because you've done something successfully on Long Island. And so if you were to expand this in Long Island, where's the public acreage that you would use? Is it rooftops?
Mostly schools, county schools buildings.
Rooftops.
County.
Yeah. Fabulous. Yeah. And I can tell you PS 41 opposite my apartment in New York has a rooftop garden.
Awesome. I love hearing this.
Right. So then what you would say is, and if you think that this is a long shot, there are X number of schools already who have devoted their rooftops to gardens and are teaching kids, da 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 da. So that's awesome. I would say about that, though, it brings the gardening thing more to children learning as opposed to feeding everybody. So I would mix the rooftop gardens with some other acreage, like parks, right? I mean, isn't there other acreage going to wait?
Anything is open. Anything that's open is available. So the court building down the block from your house, the Traffic Violations Bureau, just for somebody
Fabulous.
In between. School is really important. Because
and then who would work on those rooftops?
So depending on where the location is, so if it's something like at a court building, then you would have a centralized organization that's responsible for the professional oversight
okay.
of each
All right.
individual
Great.
Site.
All right, you've got it. All right. So, I mean, again, keep it simple, walk through the how it would work, and then end with, you know, right now, or you could start with, there are this many hungry families in Suffolk County. This would solve that problem, and call to action. You can support this initiative by, you know, reaching out to us at here, or, you know, we're proposing a bill, you know, to make funding available to growing rooftop gardens in Suffolk County, right?
Yes.
And if you email me, we can, you know, we've got a platform where people can propose bills and then they can, you know, Wikify the bill and get it adopted by a sponsor. I love that. That's great. That's wonderful. And that's the kind of essay that would be very well pitched, as Ms. Rodriguez knows, to a newspaper here in, you know, locally, and especially in Suffolk County, that start there or any Long Island newspaper. That's wonderful. Fabulous. Good. How do you feel about the way you became more and more concrete and organized as the presentation went on?
Oh, it was good. I wasn't framing any of my thoughts leading up to today in the idea of an op-ed. I was thinking of it more as the project and more as the initiative itself and all the technicalities and the who, the what, the where, and everything we just talked about.
Right, but let me share, not to interrupt you, that the skills you need to write a good op-ed are the same skills you would need to move this project along with funders, with public officials, with school officials, with students who are, you know, working for it. So they're all the same skills. And so your challenge, like every writer has a different challenge. You tend to be discursive, and a lot of writers are discursive. There's nothing wrong with, it's a temperamental thing. So your job would be to, you know, practice being focused and linear. Yeah?
Okay.
Yeah, like every time you fill in an extra detail, think, is this central or is this kind of a cul-de-sac or, you know, getting too granular, and keep it, you know, tight.
Okay.
It's wonderful. Wonderful. So good. So we've got 20 minutes. Is anyone burning to try their pitch before we use our last 20 minutes? So what I'd like you to do in these last 20 minutes, and we're zipping along, is I'd like you to just map out, you know, the points that you would make in an op-ed, like introduction, 3 points, conclusion. And then when you go home, when you have time, I just want you to write an introductory paragraph, like just start small. And then when you're ready, write a whole op-ed and then send them to me if you want to, if you want me to edit them for possible, after they're as perfected as you can possibly make them, you know, if you want me to consider them for the Daily Clout. Or you can give them to Ms. Rodriguez, and she can place them in other publications. So right now, just like think about the op-ed you want to write, a sentence or two about the introduction, a sentence or two about your first point, a sentence or two, second point, sentence or two about third point, sentence conclusion. Just a sketch, like the merest sketch. Okay, pens down, please. And again, the reason I force this is that if you're professional writers, you're writing on deadline, and you have to be ready to look at the news and just hop on it, like in an hour and a half between other commitments. I would love for you to read your notes, even if it's just, yeah. Even if it's, they're very sketchy, very preliminary. No, I don't even want you to explain them, just read them, just because we're getting a sense of the various processes people can use.
Yes, my name is Thomas Whitson from the Department of Technology and Society. So people with disabilities face unique discrimination
Excellent.
In pursuing STEM disciplines. Mm-hmm. For example, one of my students, she was given a special exam for a test, and her professor, instead of giving the exam out privately, he announced to the whole class that she was giving a special test for this reason.
Oh, God.
So obviously that's violating many laws and many regulations, and so I think professors on campus and also students on campus need to be aware of disability issues for people pursuing engineering and STEM disciplines.
Fantastic. These are your notes?
These are my notes, yeah.
Perfect. That's round of applause. That's fabulous. Fabulous. Wow. So good. So good. Did you feel how rigorous that was? Like, boom, here's the problem. Boom, here's a story. Boom, here's, you know, here's an issue. If you were teasing it out into an op-ed, I'd want a couple of examples of what you'd do to solve that.
So, an example of solving this problem.
Love it.
Last October, we hosted an event called Disability Mentoring Day. Every October is Disability Awareness Month around the nation.
Okay.
And so on campus, we held a special event to encourage students and faculty to discuss these issues and to find ways to increase disability diversity on campus.
Fantastic. And in an ideal world, you'd give some examples at the end. For example, this, and this came out of it. Round of applause again. Oof. Wonderful. Fabulous. Excellent. Excellent. Do you get like, you know, I just gave him like a minute and a half. And now I know something, and I'm like moved by it, and he has a solution. Fabulous. Someone else read their notes, please. Yes. And again, just the notes. You don't have to like have all the answers.
My name's Jonathan.
Stand up straight and tall, please.
Sure.
Thank you.
Evidence-based practice as a barrier to PTSD treatment. In the fall of 15, I went to a conference in New York City. It covered alternative medicine for PTSD in veterans.
Great.
From that, I was exposed to equine therapy and its benefits.
Oh, is equine therapy?
Equine therapy is horse therapy, using horses as a therapy modality. Then the summer, I went to a equine therapy facility on a family day for veterans. I experienced firsthand a gentleman being showing PTSD signs around the horse. They disappeared. I saw peace enter his eyes. From that, I volunteered in Nassau at an equine therapy facility, and now I'm pursuing the goal of neutralizing PTSD in veterans and non-veterans.
Through equine therapy.
Through equine therapy. The point that the op-ed would be exposing the fact that evidence-based practice is holding back a number of different therapeutic modalities because they...
Love it. Beautiful. And we're going to translate that into ordinary English. Evidence-based meaning like traditional science?
Evidence-based being, I learned it, and it's a word used frequently in the nursing community. It's got to be evidence-based. You can't just be like, oh, this might work.
Okay. So equine therapy doesn't have... peer-reviewed data, but you've seen that it works.
Correct.
And so we're closing the door on a lot of things that might work.
Yes,
that
I'm
alternative.
Using that as my wedge.
Fabulous.
For alternative medicine.
Fabulous. And then if you want to end with a policy prescription, like, you know, insurers should pay for these treatments, or the Veterans Administration should pay for these treatments, that would be the perfect op-ed. Fabulous. And again, using your own experience is such a fantastic hook for something that is very national and in the news. And wonderful, surprising, important, beautiful. Love it. Round of applause. Excellent. Write that piece. Yes. Yes. Oh, you're just holding the mic. Who else? Quick. We have time. Yeah.
So this would be the vicious cycle feeding Islamophobia and Islamic radicalization. Current proposed immigration policy is basically stoking the fear of radical Islamism. But if you look at the data, terror is not perpetrated by recently arrived immigrants. Instead, quite often they are actually the victims of hate crimes.
Hmm.
And in fact, what a recent study found that radicalization is actually a process that occurs in the United States over time.
Hmm.
So it's not that the foreign threat is not one that arrives at the shore, but it evolves over time. Mm-hmm. Probably in response to the experience of Islamophobia.
Oh, wow.
So these are two things that are interlinked with each other,
oh my God.
Feeding each other, and somehow you need to A, recognize that there's this link between those two events and processes, and try to figure out how to break that cycle.
Fantastic, so brilliant. I'm gonna unpack a little bit. So this is one of those gigantic subjects, and again, it doesn't mean you shouldn't address it. But he's using the intro that I mentioned, which is one of the tricks, which is counterintuitive, right? You'd think that, you know, terrorism comes from far away, but in fact, we're growing it at home. And you'd think that it's being grown by extremist imams, but in fact, Islamophobia causes terrorism, is what I'm hearing you say. Then you'd want data, because that's a big, sweeping, impactful thing to say. But if you have the data, I believe you, trot it out. Show it, and then, you know, this kind of piece is more of a, like, here's something you didn't know, and so obviously the conclusion would be, so instead of just, droning people if they're extremists or, you know, attacking them or using policies that heighten Islamophobia, we need to look at ending Islamophobia in our policies if we're serious about fighting terrorism. So it's a wonderful counterintuitive piece, like other giant sweeping ones. It takes a chunk of data, like you'd have to walk us through the studies, but it's a fantastic piece, and you should totally write it and totally publish it and give an example of how we could lower the level of Islamophobia in our policies. Love it. So is anyone else burning to share their, you haven't, so let's.
I didn't come really prepared with anything.
It doesn't matter. Okay. And I would love, if I could leave you with one thing, it's that you never, ever, ever, when the opportunity to share, even if you're totally unready, knocks on your door, never say, I'm not prepared, I'm not ready. Okay. Just do it. Make a fool of yourself. It'll always go better than you think.
Okay. My name's Jennifer DeVito. I'm from the library.
Great. Can you hold the mic or speak a little louder?
Okay. I actually was writing about the IMLS defunding by the recent, by the administration.
So what is IMLS?
That's the Institute for Museum and Library. I can't remember the last word, but it provides funding to public libraries and academic libraries and museum programming, and the Trump administration wants to defund it,
okay.
Which is going to negatively impact library programming, where a lot of our residents get ESL
English
as a second language, uh-huh. STEM training, and other job and career support.
Okay, great, wonderful. This is another super important op-ed. I'm so proud of all of these people. I have not heard an op-ed that shouldn't be written here. Like, these are all so important and critical. So that's great, and you're very well positioned to write it, you know. And what I'd encourage you to do is set that up. People don't know about it, explain it. And then say concretely in your own library what would be lost, and tell stories. You know, this little girl, da da da. You know, this unemployed person in our community found a job through da da. All of that is going to vanish. And fabulous, wonderful. All right. Well, it's almost 4:00. I hope you all are leaving here eager to write op-eds. Send them to Rachel. Send them to me. And send them, then, you know, we'll tell you in the next session how to send them out into the world. It's not difficult. And write them. You've got so much to say, and I want to thank you so much for, you know, being so incredibly effective on this journey just over the course of this semester of becoming public intellectuals. I'm completely impressed and blown away, and thank you for your wonderful ideas. And I just want to thank you.